Ever wondered why your toilet flush seems to have a mind of its own, swirling in a specific direction, or why hurricanes spin the way they do? Well, strap in because we're about to dive into the wide world of the Coriolis effect, nature's very own merry-go-round that's constantly spinning our planet's fluids in circles. The Coriolis effect is like Earth's hidden puppeteer, pulling the strings of our atmosphere and oceans. It's named after the French scientist Gaspard-Gustave Coriolis, who probably never imagined his discovery would one day explain everything from weather patterns to the formation of giant whirlpools in the ocean. So what exactly is this effect? Imagine you're on a giant turntable. That's basically what Earth is, spinning on its axis once every 24 hours. Now, if you try to throw a ball straight across this spinning platform, something weird happens. From your perspective on the turntable, the ball seems to curve. But if you're watching from space, you'd see the ball traveling in a straight line while the surface beneath it rotates. This apparent deflection is the heart of the Coriolis effect. It's not a real force like gravity, but rather an observed effect due to our planet's rotation. And here's the kicker. It works differently depending on which hemisphere you're in. In the northern hemisphere, moving objects appear to deflect to the right, while in the southern hemisphere, they veer to the left. Now, before you start blaming the Coriolis effect for your golf game or that swirly in your morning coffee, let's get the record straight. The effect is way too weak to influence small-scale events like these. But when we're talking about large-scale movements of air and water over long distances, that's where the Coriolis effect really flexes its muscles. Take wind patterns, for instance. Without the Coriolis effect, air would simply flow directly from areas of high pressure to low pressure. But throw our spinning Earth into the mix, and suddenly these air masses start to curve. This is why we see those beautiful spiral patterns in satellite images of storms and cyclones. In the ocean, the Coriolis effect is the reason behind the formation of gyres, massive circular ocean currents that help distribute heat around the globe. The North Atlantic Gyre, for example, is responsible for the warm Gulf Stream that keeps Europe much toastier than it would be otherwise. But the Coriolis effect isn't content with just messing with our weather and ocean currents. It also plays a crucial role in Earth's magnetic field. The liquid outer core of our planet, made mostly of iron and nickel, is constantly in motion due to convection currents. As this electrically conductive fluid moves, it generates Earth's magnetic field through a process called the dynamo effect. The Coriolis force helps organize these movements into structured patterns, contributing to the stability of our magnetic field. Now, how about some misconceptions? You might have heard that it determines the direction water spirals down your drain. Sorry to burst your bubble, but unless you have a perfectly symmetrical sink and can eliminate all other factors like water pressure and bowl shape, the Coriolis effect is far too weak to noticeably influence your drain vortex. However, there is a grain of truth to the toilet flush myth. If you scale things up significantly, the Coriolis effect does influence the rotation of large weather systems like hurricanes and typhoons. In the northern hemisphere, these storms spin counterclockwise, while in the southern hemisphere, they rotate clockwise. It's like nature's own hemispheric dance party, with each side having its own preferred direction. Interestingly, its strength varies depending on your latitude. It's strongest at the poles and weakest at the equator. This is why you don't see hurricanes forming right on the equator. There's not enough Coriolis force to get them spinning. In technology, long-range artillery has to account for it when aiming, as a projectile traveling long distances can be deflected enough to miss its target. Even some satellites and space missions need to factor in the Coriolis effect for precise calculations. In the realm of climate science, understanding this phenomena is crucial for predicting and modeling large-scale atmospheric and ocean circulation patterns. These patterns play a significant role in distributing heat and moisture around the globe, influencing everything from regional climates to the formation of deserts and rainforests. One fascinating consequence of the Coriolis effect is the creation of planetary-scale wind patterns, known as the Hadley, Farrell, and Polar Cells. These giant atmospheric conveyor belts help move heat from the equator towards the poles, driving much of Earth's weather in the process. The Coriolis effect doesn't just stop at Earth, though. It influences fluid dynamics on other rotating bodies in our solar system, too. Jupiter's Great Red Spot, a massive storm that's been raging for centuries, owes its longevity in part to the planet's rapid rotation and the resulting strong Coriolis effect. It's not easy to ignore how the Coriolis effect remains a fundamental principle in understanding the complex dance of fluids on rotating bodies. From shaping our weather to influencing the very magnetic field that protects us from solar radiation, this subtle yet powerful phenomena is a testament to the intricate and interconnected nature of our world. Now that we've spun our way through the basics of the Coriolis effect, let's dive into a phenomenon that's making waves in the Pacific, quite literally. Enter La Niña, the cooler sister in the climate phenomena family known as the El Niño Southern Oscillation, or ENSO for short. La Niña is like the ocean's version of a cold front that overstays its welcome. During a La Niña event, the eastern Pacific Ocean near South America experiences cooler than average surface temperatures. It's as if the Pacific decided to crank up its AC, but only on one side of the room. So how does this oceanic cold snap come about? It all starts with the trade winds, those steady breezes that blow from east to west along the equator. During La Niña, these winds go into overdrive, blowing stronger than usual. This wind-powered push causes warm surface water to pile up in the western Pacific near Indonesia and Australia. But here's where things get interesting. Remember the Coriolis effect? It steps in to give these strengthened trade winds an extra twist. In the southern hemisphere, the Coriolis effect deflects the winds slightly to the left, while in the northern hemisphere, it nudges them to the right. This deflection helps to reinforce the circular motion of the wind patterns, further intensifying the La Niña conditions. As the warm water is pushed westward, it's replaced by colder, nutrient-rich water from the depths of the ocean in a process called upwelling. It's like the ocean is giving itself a refreshing cold drink, except this drink has consequences for weather patterns worldwide. The cooler waters in the eastern Pacific lead to changes in atmospheric circulation. The normal convection patterns over the Pacific shift westward, following the warm water. This means more rainfall in Indonesia and northern Australia, while countries on the western coast of South America like Peru and Ecuador experience drier conditions. But La Niña's influence doesn't stop at the Pacific's edge. It's like dropping a pebble in a pond. The ripples spread far and wide, affecting weather patterns globally. In North America, La Niña typically brings cooler, wetter conditions to the Pacific Northwest and western Canada, while the southern United States often experiences warmer, drier weather. These climate shifts can have significant impacts on agriculture, water resources, and even the frequency of natural disasters. For instance, La Niña conditions are associated with an increased likelihood of Atlantic hurricanes. It's as if La Niña is nature's way of spicing things up, throwing a climate curveball that keeps meteorologists on their toes. The effects of La Niña can be both a blessing and a curse, depending on where you are. For some regions, it might mean a bumper crop year due to increased rainfall. For others, it could spell drought and economic hardship. In Australia, La Niña often brings increased rainfall, which can be great for agriculture, but also it increases the risk of flooding. One of the most fascinating aspects of La Niña is its connection to the broader ENSO cycle. ENSO is like a climate seesaw, with La Niña on one end and its warmer counterpart El Niño on the other. Between these two extremes, it's a neutral state. This cycle typically lasts anywhere from 2 to 7 years, but it's not a strict schedule. Nature likes to keep us guessing. El Niño is essentially the opposite of La Niña. During El Niño, the eastern Pacific warms up, leading to a different set of global weather impacts. This interplay between these two phenomena, along with the neutral state, creates a complex dance of ocean temperatures and atmospheric conditions that climate scientists are still working to fully understand. Historically, some La Niña events have left quite a mark. The La Niña of 2010-2012 was one for the books, causing widespread flooding in Australia and Southeast Asia, while contributing to drought conditions in the southern United States and East Africa. It's a stark reminder of how changes in ocean temperatures can have far-reaching consequences on land. Interestingly, La Niña events can sometimes occur back-to-back, a phenomenon known as a double-dip La Niña. This happened recently in 2020 to 2022, leading to prolonged impacts on global weather patterns. It's like nature decided to hit the replay button on its climate mixtape. The study of La Niña and the broader ENSO cycle is crucial for improving long-term weather forecasts and climate predictions. By understanding these patterns, scientists can better anticipate potential impacts on agriculture, water resources, and natural disaster preparedness. But here's the catch. Predicting ENSO events is no walk in the park. The ocean atmosphere system is incredibly complex, with many variables at play. It's like trying to predict the outcome of a chess game where the board keeps changing shape. Climate change adds another layer of complexity to understanding La Niña. As global temperatures rise, there's growing evidence that it might affect the frequency and intensity of ENSO events. Some studies suggest we might see even more extreme El Niño and La Niña events in the future, potentially amplifying their global impacts. La Niña also plays a role in global carbon dioxide levels. During La Niña events, the cooler waters in the eastern Pacific absorb more CO2 from the atmosphere. It's like the ocean is helping to pump the brakes on rising atmospheric CO2 levels, albeit temporarily. As we continue to unravel the mysteries of La Niña and its global impacts, one thing becomes clear. Our planet's climate is an intricate, interconnected system. From the spinning of the Earth influencing wind patterns to the temperature of the Pacific affecting rainfall in Indonesia and hurricanes in the Atlantic, it's all part of a grand planetary ballet. Understanding these connections is not just an academic exercise. It has real-world implications for millions of people. From farmers planting their crops to city planners preparing for potential natural disasters, knowledge of La Niña and its effects is a powerful tool for adaptation and resilience in the face of our ever-changing climate. Do you have any memory of experiencing the effects of La Niña? Let us know in the comments below. Moving on, let's talk about the current state of play. As of 2024, we're in a neutral ENSO phase, which is like the ocean's version of a coffee break between its hot and cold shifts. But neutral doesn't mean inactive. Climate scientists are constantly monitoring a slew of indicators, from sea surface temperatures to wind patterns, trying to piece together the puzzle of what might come next. One key player in this prediction game is the subsurface temperature of the Pacific Ocean. It's like checking the water temperature before diving in. What's happening below the surface can give us clues about future conditions. Cooler subsurface temperatures in the eastern Pacific could be a harbinger of La Niña conditions. But here's where it gets as twisty as a pretzel. Climate change is throwing a wrench into our prediction models. As global temperatures rise, it's like we're playing ENSO bingo with a set of loaded dice. Some studies suggest that climate change could lead to more frequent and intense El Niño events, while others point to potential increases in La Niña frequency. It's a scientific tug of war that's keeping climatologists up at night. Speaking of climate change, let's talk about the elephant in the room, or should we say the CO2 in the atmosphere. Rising global temperatures are altering the delicate balance of our climate system. It's like trying to ride a bicycle while someone's constantly adjusting the seat height. You can still pedal, but it's getting increasingly unpredictable. One fascinating aspect of this climate change ENSO interaction is the potential for flavors of La Niña. Just as ice cream comes in different varieties, scientists have identified different types of La Niña events. There's the Eastern Pacific La Niña, where cooling is concentrated in the Eastern Pacific, and the Central Pacific La Niña, where the cooling is more centralized. Climate change could potentially shift the likelihood of these different flavors, adding another layer of complexity to our predictions. Now, let's put on our speculation hats and imagine a La Niña event in 2025. What might it look like? Well, based on historical patterns and current trends, we could be in for a wild ride. A 2025 La Niña could potentially bring increased rainfall to Southeast Asia and Australia. Great news for water reservoirs, but it might also mean a higher risk of flooding. On the flip side, the southwestern United States might need to brace for drier conditions. It's like La Niña is playing favorites with rainfall, giving some areas a soaking while leaving others high and dry. This could have significant implications for agriculture and water management in affected regions. In the Atlantic, a 2025 La Niña could set the stage for a more active hurricane season. It's as if La Niña is nature's version of a party planner, creating atmospheric conditions that are just right for hurricane formation. This could mean increased risk for coastal communities and a need for enhanced disaster preparedness. But here's the twist. The impacts of a potential 2025 La Niña might not be a carbon copy of past events. As our climate continues to change, we're entering uncharted territory. It's like trying to navigate using an old map in a landscape that's constantly shifting. One area of particular interest is the Arctic. Some studies suggest that La Niña events could influence Arctic sea ice extent. In 2025, La Niña might contribute to a temporary slowdown in Arctic ice melt, providing a brief respite for the region's fragile ecosystems. However, it's important to note that this would be a temporary effect against the backdrop of long-term Arctic warming. In the realm of global food production, a 2025 La Niña could shake things up like a climatological cocktail mixer. While some regions might see bumper crops due to increased rainfall, others could face challenges. For instance, La Niña conditions often lead to drier weather in key grain-producing areas of South America. This could potentially impact global food prices and supply chains, underscoring the far-reaching consequences of these climate patterns. Another fascinating aspect to consider is the impact on marine ecosystems. La Niña's cooler waters and increased upwelling in the eastern Pacific bring nutrient-rich waters to the surface. This could lead to a boom in phytoplankton growth, potentially boosting fish populations. It's like La Niña is serving up an all-you-can-eat buffet for marine life. But let's not forget about our feathered friends. A 2025 La Niña could influence bird migration patterns. Changes in temperature and precipitation can affect the timing of migrations and the availability of food sources along migratory routes. It's as if La Niña is rewriting the travel itinerary for millions of birds. The complexity of La Niña underscores the importance of continued research and improved climate models. It's like we're constantly updating our GPS system to navigate the twists and turns of our changing climate. Each ENSO event, whether El Niño or La Niña, provides valuable data that helps refine our understanding and improve future predictions. As we look towards 2025 and beyond, one thing is clear. Our relationship with climate phenomena like La Niña is evolving. We're not just passive observers anymore. Our actions are influencing the very systems we're trying to predict. It's a sobering reminder of our interconnectedness with the planet's climate systems. I hope today's episode gave a wake-up call to get everyone moving to help alleviate the climate crisis. Every small step helps. If you like this episode, don't forget to hit like and subscribe. We make valuable content for you as often as we can. Stay insanely curious.